It seems to have become a good practice to position talks on chance cards. So this one is on the tower, I believe. So Sean said, going forward, maintaining and supporting data curation and software is going to be an important task, and I agree. My personal sort of small success story here is that like 15 years after putting Waltz online, we managed to put GramBank online. So something can be done, something has been done. And like Sean, I had to think about what to talk about. Russell already mentioned the word GramBank 2.0, and I just take the opportunity to push my own agenda, appreciating Russell's liking disagreement, possibly. So GramBank has been designed from the outset to be global. A big part of the motivation was to be the better, more complete Waltz. So it doesn't cater for particular areas, despite sales being one of the sources of the data. There's no particular family that was in the minds of the database creators, I think, despite contact, for example, with the Eurotip project. And the topical coverage was supposed to be broad, despite phonology being taken out deliberately, because there seem to be better sources which are already of global coverage available. But still, people, topologists, linguists, do create and use specialized topological data sets. And I mean, after 15 years, I'm still not a linguist, but I'm still a database person. And I've seen plenty of these, and I'll go through a couple of these now. There are data sets with regional focus. We've seen a couple of mentions of the South American indigenous language structures. There's, for example, Henrik Liljegren's Hindikush data set. Recently, there was a publication of the Kiel South Asia Topological Database. There are probably tons more, and I highlight a couple of the things that is done differently from GramBank in these data sets. The sales data is sort of special in that it is it has a regional focus, but still, due to the region being South America, it has many different languages from different families. The Hindu Kush topological data set is special in that it also comes with lexical data plus audio, so you can do funny things like have the words for a certain concept be played from all the languages in the sample. Then we have data sets that target a specific domain. For example, Mark Tang's Word Atlas of Classifier Languages that was recently published. Sean already talked about Foible, and we'll talk about that later too, which is a repository of cross-linguistic phonological inventory data. One of the earliest data sets that I was involved with is the Frank Seifert's Survey of Affix Borrowing. And Matthew Dreyer's word order chapters in Waltz can probably be considered sort of global domain-specific data sets as well. Again, a couple of specialties in these data sets. The survey of affix borrowing isn't about single languages, but instead about donor-recipient pairs of languages, which brings in an interesting new concept in terms of the data model. Foible isn't the typical questionnaire type topological data set, but instead it collects phoneme inventories, meaning that features in Foible are basically phonemes, and the values for these features are yes or no, language X has phoneme Y or not. Then there are family-specific data sets. We'll hear about Eurotip today, tomorrow, I don't know. And one that I've been recently involved with is the Comparative Caribbean Database. Again, there's probably tons more of these. Eurotip has a specialty, not only topological data, but speaker area polygons. And I believe in the data set that we took the polygons from, there's even historical data. about speakers. So it basically shows what you can do with a more focused interest in getting better data. The comparative Caravan database does not only have typological data on, I believe, mostly morphology, but also classification trees, basically with different classification proposals for the family in question. So again, there's all sorts of different things you can do with these kinds of data sets. So considering that GramBank is fairly big, couldn't all these be just part of GramBank, because GramBank's that big after all? It's clear that we do want these special databases because due to the different focus, they allow us to do more. EuroTIP, for example, also comes with examples for most of the values. Can't we have both? Can't we have all the data, but all in GramBank? So GramBank 2.0 could be this beautiful one-stop shop. Just drive there, get whatever you want. But I'm proposing something different, namely that FAIR typological data already fulfills many of the things we would like to get from GramBank 2.0. Most of you might be familiar with the FAIR guiding principles for scientific data management and stewardship. The FAIR in FAIR guiding principles stands for findable, accessible, interoperable, and reusable. And I go through the four aspects of FAIR data in a minute. Interoperability is described as the data usually need to be integrated with other data. We've seen plenty of that use case already. In addition, the data need to interoperate with applications or workflows for analysis, storage, and processing. That's clearly something we want. Reusability is described as the ultimate goal of FAIR. To achieve this, metadata and data should be well described so that they can be replicated and or combined in different settings. Yes, we want that too. And the cross-linguistic data format arguably already makes linguistic data interoperable and reusable. The screenshots I showed you a couple of minutes ago are strong evidence for this, because being able to shove out web applications for cross-linguistic databases is only feasible at this scale because the underlying data model is clear-cut enough, and actually all the underlying data for all the databases I've shown you is available as CLDF datasets. So CLDF does provide all the interoperability we need to put data sets on the web, but it also provides all the interoperability to aggregate data across data sets. That's possible mostly through Glottolog, because we can unambiguously identify languages across data sets. Grammaticon may provide similar interoperability in terms of grammatical concepts. And I also argue that CLDF lays the foundations for the findability aspect, because it provides ways to include enough metadata with data sets to allow platforms like Zenodo to spit out tons of data sets if you search for CLDF structure data set as keyword, for example. Martin will talk about CrossGram tomorrow, which arguably adds the accessibility to FAIR typological data. It could help the user find the required data and access it, including knowing how to use it by attaching clear-cut licenses. Now, what CLDF gives us as well is more typology, for example, because you can also access autotyp data in the same way, but also more than typology. For example, Lexibank and dplace data. I just computed the overlap between these data sets and GramBank by computing the number of shared Glottolog languages in them. For autotyp, it's 1,500, Lexibank almost 1,000, dplace still 660. And now I'll switch to giving you a couple of examples for how that interoperability works. I'm sticking to like common guidelines for mathematics talks, like the first third is understandable for everyone, second third for most, last third for nobody. Last third starts now. So for these examples, I'm using what I'm now consider the killer feature of CLDF, and that's by being a serialization format for relational databases, we can convert each and every CLDF data set automatically into an SQLite database. SQLite is a great relational database engine, and it also comes with an attach database command that allows you to seamlessly access data from different data sets, and in our case, different CLDF data sets converted to SQLite. So we get efficient data access across multiple data sets. That's how I computed the intersection between GramBank and these other global data sets before. The intersection is a fairly simple SQL statement. And the beauty of that is that for computing the intersection of GramBank with any other CLDF data set that has languages, you just need to switch out the file name of the SQLite version of the data set in the statement, and you get the intersection with a whatever other data set. A slightly more complex example is if we want to integrate GramBank data with Foible. As we said, there's no phonology in GramBank because of Foible, and it actually is easy to basically compute Waltz's phonology data from Foible and integrate that with GramBank. Another big advantage of this CLDF SQL thing that I mentioned before is that for SQL, there's tons of good tooling. For example, there's tools that let you visually inspect a database schema. One of them is implemented in the command cldfbench cldfwiz.erd. So that's an entity relationship diagram, basically a way to visualize the tables in the database and how they relate. We see a couple of things that we might have expected, like there's a language table, a value table, and a parameter table, as we would expect in most topological data sets that have been converted to CLDF. But we see one specialty, namely that the value table has a foreign key to a table called inventories.csv. The reason for that is Foible might have multiple inventories for the same language. So if we want to compute, for example, number of consonants for one language, we have to make sure that we only take individual inventories. So that's what we're going to do now. We will compute Waltz's feature 1A, which is consonant inventory size, I believe, from Foible. Everything is in there, and we can basically, it's basically probably also how Ian Madison actually did it, because Foible contains all the UCLA phonological segment inventory database inventories, the ones collected by Ian Madison, and we can count the consonants. Again, it's this time a slightly more complex SQL query. We again just attach the database we want to look at. We do know that there's something like a value table that contains membership information between language and phoneme. Down there where it says segment class equals consonant, we limit the results to just the consonants. We limit the results to just the inventories coming from upsit or whatever you pronounce that. And in the upper select, you see that we count the consonants. So in some sense, we do better than Waltz because we get actual counts out there and not just batched counts. But we could also just adapt that to get the actual batches that Waltz uses, like big, small, medium, or something. Now getting a feature out of GramBank is a little easier because GramBank is a typical questionnaire type topological database. Again, there's a value table, and we know that there is one because it's a CLDF data set. There's a language table. In GramBank, we know that the language IDs are glottal codes. And again, we extract triples, parameter, language, and value. Now, plugging these two together is easy because in SQL, you can easily combine queries into bigger ones. Here's the bigger outer query. So where it says gb.gb165, that's the query we've just seen. foible.walls_1a is the query we've seen before. Plug these in here. Then, as you would expect, we union the data points, intersect the languages to only get data points for languages that appear in both features. And then the more important aspect is we select four columns, an artificially made up ID column, again, the parameter, the language, and the value. And what's important about that is these four columns basically make up a valid CLDF data set. So if we can get this four column table into a file, we'll have a CLDF data set that we can run out of the mill or off the shelf tools on. That's what we do here. We just run SQLite, feed it the query, and output the result to a file called values.csv. And with that file, we can just use a command that is available in the CLDF WISP package that you can install on your machine, feed it the synthesized database dataset values.csv, inform it that we are interested in the two parameters that we put in there, then customize the color, shape, whatever, and get out a map like this. Now my me not being a linguist shows up here because I didn't spend a lot of time looking up more meaningful grammar features. I highlighted this one language because it happens to be the only one having one for this feature in our data set. I don't know how meaningful that is, but the gist should be that creating that map from GramBank and some other data source is easy enough. So in conclusion, I hope I showed that CLDF actually does make data interoperable, but you still need to understand data set specifics. These data set specifics are also easier to find out because CLDF comes with tons of metadata and tools to, for example, visually inspect the database schema. So you still need to know your data, but you can forget about things like where to find the language metadata, whether language codes are ISO codes or WALS codes, whether data is comma separated or tab separated, or there are new lines in columns of the comma separated data, whatever. So essentially, I think FAIR topological data is already GramBank 2.0. The CLDF shopping mall beats the one-stop shop, and it's already here. Thank you.